salt water, such a humble ingredient, but at a time in history, it was a part of a medical wonder, the one that helped doctors to see through the chest and diagnose a wide range of heart disease. We are talking about the birth of the electrocardiogram, or as you may have heard of, the ECG, and how can salt water play a vital part in this advanced instrument? The origin of the ECG long began with the discovery of electrical effects on the body. In the late 18th century, Dr. Peter Christian Abigat, a Danish physician, demonstrated the reviving effects of electric shock by shocking the hand repeatedly. A shock to the head to kill and a shock to the chest to bring it back to life. 10 years later, in 1786, Dr. Luigi Galvani did many sophisticated experiments on the frog and discovered that the muscle system and the nervous system was related to electricity. These two outstanding experiments had laid the foundation for future research of bioelectricity in living creatures. But not until 5 decades later did research about cardiac electricity show up. In 1842, Italian physicist Carlo Mattozzi demonstrated the relationship between cardiac contraction and electric current, which was later generalized to muscle contraction by Emile Dubois-Raymond and set the tone for electrophysiology research. Cardiac electrophysiology was further studied by other scientists, and many instruments were invented to measure these phenomena. But the most noticeable instrument in the early 1870s must be the capillary electrometer, which was invented by French physicist Gabriel Lippmann after his observation of a droplet of mercury covered by sulfuric acid when in contact with an iron wire. The Lippmann instrument was very interesting at the time. It consisted of a glass tube that contained mercury, with one tip was drawn into a very small diameter tube called capillary and submerged into a bath of sulfuric acid. Changes of electrical energy was measured by the movement of mercury in the capillary, which can be observed carefully with a microscope and can be recorded with a moving photosensitized paper. Using this instrument, Dr. Auguste Desiré Waller was able to record the first ever heart electrogram from the intact human heart at St. Mary's Hospital in 1887. A bit information about the current ECG or electrocardiogram. Usually, ECG will be measured with 12 leads, which means that it will look at the heart at 12 different angles. Each lead will be measured by a pair of electrodes, positive and negative, and it will give information about the P, Q, R, S, and T wave, which basically represent the electrical current in your heart. P is for atrial depolarization, so electricity passes through the atria. The QRS complex with 3 waves represents ventricle depolarization, so electricity passes through the ventricles, and T is for ventricles repolarization, meaning the heart's getting ready for a new cycle. The first heart electrogram by Dr. Waller, however, could only measure one lead, with the electrodes stuck into the front and the back of the chest. And despite its sensitivity of 25 microvolt, the apparatus could not effectively distinguish the P from the QRS complex, thus showing only the depolarization and repolarization of the ventricles, of which he named V1 and V2. The readings was also easily distorted due to the instability of the mercury and also due to the sensitivity to vibration. Perhaps because of the drawbacks of this machine, and because the study of electrophysiology was still very young back then, Dr. Waller did not believe in the potential of his work in clinical uses. Even as late as 1911, more than 20 years after his performance at St. Mary's Hospital, he said, "I do not imagine that electrocardiography is likely to find any very extensive use in the hospital. It can be at most of rare and occasional use to afford a record of some rare anomaly of cardiac action." It seemed as though everything would collapse and fade into oblivion, but fortunately, the stage at St. Mary's Hospital wasn't the only performance of heart electrogram. Dr. Waller continued to share his work in other exhibitions, and most importantly, in 1889, at the first International Congress of Physiology, he performed it again. This time, Dr. Willam Einthoven was there, witnessing every details of the work and became very intrigued at the age of 27. A new era of electrocardiography was about to happen. Willem Einthoven was born in the Dutch East Indies, which is known as Indonesia nowadays. He studied medicine in the Netherlands, received his PhD degree at the University of Leiden, and worked as a professor of respiratory physiology. And since around the year of 1890, especially after witnessing Dr. Waller's work, he became interested in the electrical activity of the heart. It all began again with the capillary electrometer, but with a twist. Other scientists at that time, namely William Bayliss and Edward Stadling, approached the matter in the technical aspects, like improving the light and using stronger microscope. They could distinguish three deflections instead of two, which was very close to the truth already. But Dr. Einthoven just took one step further. Not only did he use physics to enhance the reading of the capillary electrometer, he also used complex mathematics to amplify his results, making him the first person ever to correctly identify the five electrical deflections of the heart. In his paper in 1895, he named these five deflections PQRST. The reason for this letter was perhaps by taking inspiration from René Descartes' coordinates graph, and also ABCD had already been used to describe the original waveform before correction. But even with such achievements, Dr. Einthoven was not happy. The more he worked on it, the more he realized that the poor frequency response of the apparatus might limit its clinical uses. So he turned his attention to the galvanometers. Inspired by the French scientists Arsène Dachsonvand and Clément Ader, Einthoven modified the original galvanometers into the string galvanometer. This instrument consisted of a thin silver-coated quartz string stretched across two massive electromagnets. When electric current passed through, the string would swing side to side, indicating the strength and direction of the current. This oscillation was observed with a microscope and recorded with a photographic plate, which moved at a speed of 25 mm per second, so that 1 mm of length represented 0.04 seconds. Also, the tension of the string can be adjusted so that 1 mm of height recorded on the plate represents about 0.1 millivolt. But despite all the upgrades, the reading would have failed anyway unless the input information was done right. So thinking about how to connect the machine to the patient was one of the most critical challenges Einthoven had to face. In Dr. Waller's performances, he experiments with many electrodes, including silver spoons, salt water, and the zinc electrodes, which were Dr. Waller's favorites as they provided clearer and more reliable readings. But for Einthoven, the results were different. Dr. Einthoven tested with zinc electrodes, bronze electrodes, and even silver electrodes, and after vigorous testing, he soon figured out that metal electrodes would introduce noise to the reading. This was due to the complex interaction between the metal and the skin upon contact, which could distort the weak electrical current from the heart, or sometimes it was due to skin irritation, making them less ideal for repeated or prolonged uses. This was when salt water came in. When tested with salt water, this humble reagent eliminated all problems caused by metal electrodes. Salt water offered a more stable and reliable connection, reducing electrical resistance and interference that could occur with metal electrodes. So while being very easy to use, as the subjects just had to immerse their hands and feet into the bucket of salt water, the reagent helped in capturing more accurate heart electrical activity since it provided a smoother, more consistent electrical pathway. And there we have it, pockets of salt water, the string galvanometer, the power supply for the electromagnets, and the cooler for the power supply. Together, the original ECG machine was invented, with the weight of a vending machine filling up two rooms and required five people to operate. This cumbersome machine was first described in 1901 and first reported its use in electrocardiography in 1902. Since it was very heavy and difficult to move around, collecting data from hospitalized patients might be impossible. But instead of giving up, Einthoven came up with a very creative idea at that time, and that was to use telephone cables to transmit the electrical impulses from the faraway patients to his lab, where he used the string galvanometer to record the ECG. So not only did he invent the ECG machine, he was also the first one to measure an ECG online, of which he called the telecardiogramma in his paper in 1906. With the technology at hand, studies of electrocardiograph burst forth. Einthoven himself took it even further when he discovered the rarely occurred U deflection of the heart, completing the collections of waves as PQRSDU, which is still being used today. He also developed a system of triaxial bipolar with three leads at 1, 2, and 3. Although it falls short of today's standard of trail leads, the system was still a critical stepping stone for the development of vector cardiography. Even Dr. Waller, the one who had lost faith in his electrocardiogram before, came back with inspiration and analyzed 3,000 ECGs in his 1921 publication. Other scientists have also contributed massively. For instance, Dr. Thomas Lewis, who truly bridged the gap between ECG and clinical uses, and Dr. Frank Wilson, who discovered the remaining 9 leads to complete the standards of ECG reading. And many, many other doctors have discovered and described various techniques and phenomena, slowly perfecting the art of ECG. Nowadays, ECG is no longer cumbersome. It is a small machine that can be brought anywhere with ease. Holter ECG is even smaller and can read ECG 24/7. And even smartphone ECG is a thing now. But all of that could not come to life if it isn't for the great Willam Einthoven, with his invention of the string galvanometer and the mathematics behind it. That's why in 1924, Dr. Willam Einthoven was awarded with the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine for the discovery of the mechanism of the electrocardiogram. So, there we have it. Salt water for the Nobel Prize. Of course, it must come with a twist to make the humble and ordinary ingredient into a part of a medical wonder. With that being said, perhaps it's your turn now. Do you think you can work out any magic to the surrounding ingredients in your kitchen? Leave a comment below of what you think, and don't forget to subscribe for more content in the future. And in case you want to know how did ancient people deal with pneumonia without antibiotics, you can check it out right here or visit my channels for more details. Thanks for watching and see you soon.